My goal here is I want to equip you guys with the secret to landing in tech. I've interviewed with Google, I've interviewed with LinkedIn, I've interviewed with Uber, Airbnb, and as you know, I'm currently at Amazon. Most of these companies differ slightly when it comes to their core values and leadership. From Uber to LinkedIn to Google, they're all different. But there's a couple unifying things that they care about. One of those things that they care about is impact. And they care about how you illustrate impact with data. And I'm gonna get into that more as I go through the slides. A lot of people think that landing at a tech company requires being smarter than someone else, right? Requires a better education, a higher GPA, but really it just comes down to hard ass work. That's the only thing. Because the ingredients are available. I'll show you where the ingredients are available. And if you put in the time and you put in the effort, there's a very strong percentage of you who will have a chance of getting into one of these companies. So in the talk, I'm gonna be going over a combination of practical ingredients that when mixed together will give you success. These steps include foundational elements like the resume. I was just at one of the resume review sessions earlier this morning helping students with that. We're gonna be going over outreach to employers and some tactics that I have used to grab recruiters' attention and get offers within 24 hours. And then also, I'm gonna be talking about crushing interviews. So why big tech? A lot of people think that they wanna work in big tech for the reputation and the money. And that's absolutely true. There is a ton of brand equity from these companies that other companies will try to poach you once you're already in this system of top tech. Now, one of the other things that comes along with resume prestige and working at these top tech companies is that if you have a decision to work at a small company, you don't have nearly the amount of upward opportunity and upward mobility, right? There may be one senior engineer at a small organization, and when you're at Amazon, you can switch teams in 30 days. You're not getting the traction. You can go to another team, you can try another role, and these companies allow you to kind of have that flow and find the things that you're really interested in and grow where you want to grow, and that's very difficult at smaller organizations. Now, from an engineering standpoint, here are some of the salaries. You're looking at Microsoft starting engineering, 159K. Amazon, 149. Google, 186. These are really good, right? Google's a little bit higher because it's in California. Taxes are higher, right? So actually, they wind up all being generally the same. But as you grow within these companies, they provide way more stock to you. And that stock is the really, really lucrative thing, right? I joined at Amazon and the stock was $800 a share. Now the stock is worth $1,600 or $1,700 a share, right? And so whatever they're paying you winds up almost being double in this type of market. So it can be extremely lucrative. Now, for marketing and sales and anyone else that's in a different type of role, this website is called levels.fyi. Great website to check junior engineering jobs against product management, from starting salaries to all the way down to senior. Now, Glassdoor.com and some of the other major job websites, they're great to find salaries for some of the other roles like in marketing. Levels.fyi doesn't have that though. Let's see. One of the other things too at big tech, 4 months after I joined Amazon, this is what winds up happening when you get in. Google called me and they asked me if I wanted a job. 4 months later, they're like, I see you're at Amazon, this is great, would you like to come work for us? Right, so it's that quick because they are swarming for talent and they already know you're in. So they have the ability to pay and poach you out And oftentimes, money is no object. So let's talk about practical steps. Foundational elements, resume, LinkedIn profile. Let's talk about outreach and some tactics that I've used. And let's talk about crushing interviews. Foundational element number one, the resume. So I've seen a lot of bad resumes from people trying to get into Amazon. And I feel that if you stick with this structure, you will have success. There are tons of different structures that you can use. And I'm not saying this one is the perfect one. So I don't want you to get hung up on, oh my God, does it have to be exactly that way? Because it doesn't. As long as you illustrate that you are demonstrating impact, you will be successful. Your education section could be up here, your education section could be down there, but at the end of the day, as long as you care about impact and you're not really wordy and you're very specific about what your intent is on your resume, you'll have success. Here's some pointers though. The resume should have five sections. Your basic header, your summary section, and that summary section may include some skills, a related experience section, your education section, top or bottom. Sometimes, most oftentimes, I like to put the education section on the bottom because the actual experience matters more than the education, even if it's an internship or a project. And number five is the additional experience. Maybe some other extracurriculars or things that set you apart could also be useful. I'm going to go a little bit deeper onto these as well. The first three sections. So the header should have your relevant contact information. If you're an engineer, you should have your GitHub profile. Surprisingly, at the event that I was at this morning, most people didn't have their GitHub as a link. Most people had LinkedIn, but they didn't have LinkedIn on their header. All very important. Section two, you should have your job title in this section. And it's not one person that went to the event today, I probably talked to 30 people, not one person had a job title written at the top of their resume. I had to ask every single person, what are you doing? Right? Because me as the hiring manager, I'm trying to find out if you're a specific fit for some need that I have. You are filling that need, right? So if you're going after an internship position, it's as simple as saying engineering intern with a focus of machine learning, engineering intern with a focus of web dev, something along those lines cues to me that that's what you're interested in and that's what you're going to bring to the table. So in section two, you can play the summary as achievements, or you can play the summary as key interests and related experience. If you actually have some internship experience, then put the thing that you're most proud of in that summary, right? I've achieved this, and I've achieved that, right? Hook me as the reader to make me want to read your resume for more than the average time, which is 6 seconds. There was one person that I was speaking to today, and he said he could solve a Rubik's Cube in a few seconds blindfolded. And I said, that's awesome. Put that in your summary, because as quirky as that is, it's something that actually differentiates you. It makes me say, huh, that's really weird. Like, why did he put that in here? I want to read more. So things that you may not think are very valuable about your background might actually be the thing that makes somebody read your resume for more than a few seconds. You could also put some skills in this section. I like to put them up there, just with kind of pipes separating them. Actual hard skills, not Microsoft Office, something tangible, right? Something that you're gonna bring to the table from the day you begin. And section three, the related experience section. I like to stick to 3 to 5 bullet points, and I like to lead with impact. So a lot of people that I was there, you know, in the resumes I was reviewing this morning, a lot of people were not getting to the point quick enough, right? They would say, I did this thing and it improved customers, which then led to an 11% increase in something. I said, no, you need to take the 11%, put that in the front of your resume. You're leading with impact. Created an 11% change year over year from doing XYZ. Much different. Much, much different. And so, I'm gonna touch on that on another slide. One question that you can kind of ask yourself is a qualifying question for every bullet point that you write. Another thing too that I think is important is that if the company name is somebody that you don't know or somebody that someone else in this room wouldn't know, right? If it's not an Amazon or a Google or a household name, right? Put a description of the company just underneath the company name so I know what I'm reading, right? A company that specializes in web apps for small businesses, great. Okay, then I'm reading your bullet points and I'm going, ah, okay, I understand the impact and I understand the context. Context is very important. And lastly, this may go without saying, but you want to try to cater the skills and experience that you have to the role that you're going after. You have to be kind of a master of something, right? And stand for something on the resume. Okay, bullet points. This is the type of general bullet point that I get. Worked with merchant services providers to generate new business. So I want you to ask yourself the question, how many, how much, and what's the impact? How many, how much, what's the impact, right? How many merchant services providers did you work with, right? How much did it generate? And was it actually impactful? Because if it generated like, you know, 10%, but that was only, you know, $50,000 of business, it's not that impactful. Like, show me that. Now, if you've had internships, maybe you don't have any achievements on there. That's okay, right? Do the best job you can, but as you start getting into your career, you want to think about how is the thing that I'm doing right now going to display as a one-liner on this resume, and how do I measure it? Okay, section 4, section 5, pretty easy, education. Some people that I saw today, they put the education on the top, GPA. Some people like to put GPA, some people don't. Honestly, first year out of school, once you have a little bit of experience, GPA is irrelevant. So if you have a terrible GPA, no problem, right? Don't put it on there. If they ask, tell them what it is. Related coursework to the specific role. And then if you have any additional experience, maybe it's unrelated, that's okay. Honestly, to me, it shows that you have work history and you have staying power, right? You've kind of been in it for a little while, and I think that's important. Cover letter. This is Google's submission form for their application. It says, we think your work speaks for itself. There's no need to write a cover letter, right? They're kind of setting this trend. Show me your work, right? Do you have a LinkedIn profile? Great. Do you have a GitHub? Great. Let's see what you've done, right? That's what they care about. I think that, you know, I like to say that if you're applying and praying for a job, you need a cover letter, and you're still not going to get the job. Let's talk about LinkedIn profile. Who has one? Awesome. Great. Okay. Who uses it actively? Okay. Great. That's great. LinkedIn has this thing called all-star status. Okay. It's not really like a thing, but it actually helps with search. Very, very important for search. So when you log into LinkedIn, there's these different layers of profile status: beginner, intermediate, advanced, expert. And there's a simple equation to being found by recruiters at these big companies because they're looking all the time. And that equation is profile completeness equals all-star status, and all-star status equals being found. Simple as that. The main reason that I got my role at Amazon was because of my LinkedIn profile. They reached out to me. I didn't have to do any work whatsoever. They found my LinkedIn profile because it was an all-star status profile. They found me in search because of it. Now, one of the things that's really interesting is that there's 500 million users with LinkedIn, and according to LinkedIn stats, users who complete their profiles are 40 times more likely to receive opportunities. And this is super easy, guys. Super, super easy. Let me show you something. All you need to do is do these 8 things. Profile picture. It doesn't even have to be necessarily a quality picture. Just the fact that you have a picture qualifies for all-star status. Headline, which is your tagline. So I would be, Amazon product management. Summary description, which is the information right under your tagline, that big white box of information. You can write anything. Work experience, skills, that's really easy. Industry and location, really easy, takes you 2 minutes. Education, and then 50 connections. That's it. Okay, let's talk about outreach. Apply and pray. Everybody came to me at the event and was like, the applicant tracking system. I'm like, guys, good luck doing that, okay? Because it barely ever works. If you got Harvard on your resume or something, okay, awesome. Maybe you'll get a look, but it rarely ever works. It was funny. I did a test a couple months ago. I applied to 30 jobs with the exact specific role title. My resume was catered. I was just like doing market research. Out of 30 companies I applied to, one called me back. And I was a perfect fit with Amazon on my resume. So low chances for success there. Referral. This is gold, guys. If someone can refer you, as you know, it's really important. Also, the person referring you gets paid. Okay? At American Express, the referral for a senior engineer was almost $10,000. Okay? Damn right I'm going to refer you. Right? So, but there is a lot of integrity involved in the referral, right? I really do have to know you. I'm not going to just submit a referral, right? Because my reputation is on the line also, right? So I have to weigh those things. Another thing that's great about the referral is what I tell candidates that are looking for a referral, I tell them to write me a one paragraph intro about them. I then take it, I repackage it, and I send that email from me internally to the hiring manager, and I go, I got a guy, I got a girl, I got somebody that's awesome, look at their resume, right? It avoids the entire apply and pray process because instantly they're looking at the top of the pile, right? I've circumvented layer after layer of recruiter and politics, and I've gotten right to the source. Informationals, this is really powerful, but there's a small nuance here, guys. I have a YouTube video about this, how to network on LinkedIn, find a job without asking for a job. This is the nuance. You ask somebody for coffee, you tell them you're gonna time box it to 30 minutes. Because for me, we're all super busy, right? And I get this message and I go, really, I really wanna help, but man, I don't know what I'm getting into, right? If somebody time boxes it, then I go, okay, cool. Max 30 minutes, I got that time, right? I'm willing to do that. And I say to them, I wanna know everything about you. It's not about me. I wanna know everything about you, right? What are your struggles? What is product management or engineering like at Amazon? What do you like about the company? What do you don't like about the company? And at the very end of that conversation, I don't even ask them for a job. But what they do, because I've been asking them about them so much, is they naturally are curious about what you need. So they say to you, how can I help you, right? That's super powerful, right? So if it comes to the end of the conversation, you just had coffee and they don't ask you, no problem, it's fine. But 9 times out of 10, they're going to, and that's amazing, right? Because that is a golden referral. So I know a career fair is coming up pretty soon here, guys. And what I love to do at career fairs is I love to kind of go around the front of the booth, right? There's this line. And I like to go to the front. And I like to look at the business cards of the people that are there. And I like to see the name tags that are there, right? And I go on LinkedIn real quick. And I find out everything I can in 15 minutes about these people, okay? And I find out if they've written articles on LinkedIn, if they have posts, if they have like prolific GitHubs, like I wanna know what is going on with these people. And when I approach them, I'm also approaching them with a very specific role in mind. So I'm saying, I know this role from this ML team, I have an ML background, I wanna do this thing, I saw you wrote this article, I'm super impressed by it, and I make a connection, right? Most people are going to a career fair, and they're going up to the booth, and they're going, what do you have for me? No, what can I do for you? Here's what I know I can do for you, right? That is powerful, right? That's what gets your attention. All right, so a couple really interesting things here, guys. LinkedIn is so powerful for finding a job. I cannot even express this to you, but I want to show it, all right? Nikhil Goel, the head of product for Uber Aviation, Sky Taxis. He sent this post, excited to share a recap video for 2018 Uber Elevate Summit. There was 48 comments on that post. By the time I saw that post, there was like 5 comments. Now, most people on LinkedIn are not writing an article every day. But as soon as you like an article, or you comment on an article, or comment on a share that they've done, you get the notification, right? Instantly, I check my phone. Oh, somebody liked my post. It plays to their ego, right? Somebody liked what I did, right? Use that to your advantage. Check this out. So I wrote, oh my God, this is so damn awesome. Thanks for sharing, Nikhil. That took me 10 seconds. He sent me a private message. Thanks, John. I'm hiring product leaders. Interested by chance? Okay. So, here's another one. Amy Schultz, product lead for LinkedIn. She shared an article that was about artificial intelligence and how AI is not going to take over the world anytime soon. It's not going to take over jobs anytime soon. I wrote a comment that was insightful, and I said, I disagree. I said, I think AI, this article is not talking about the exponential growth of AI. This article is avoiding that. And if you look at the exponent of AI, I think jobs will be taken away in mass. Here's what happened. Baldeep, hey John, I'm Bell. I'm reaching out to you because I believe that with your experience, you can contribute greatly to product teams here. It's great, right? 10 seconds of my work, 2 roles right there. Right? You know what I like to do as a sport? I like to friend recruiters all the time on LinkedIn. Right? I don't feel like there's any security in corporate America, okay? These companies rise and fall all the time, right? It's very scary. When I was at American Express, there was 300-400 people that got let go. My whole floor was eliminated right before Christmas, okay? These are the things that happen in corporate, okay? And I like to cover my ass all the time, right? I'm constantly friending recruiters. I'm constantly friending people at other companies, right? I'm spending a lot of time networking outside of my own company. Because if I ever need a parachute, I can get one in 10 seconds, right? I think that's really valuable, right? Now, another thing you can do, there's a guy, Alex Ortiz. He's in blockchain technology. He wrote this 2,000-word article, Why You Should Hire Me. Great article. Really high quality images that he puts in there. And he says, I'm here to tell you, if you hire me, we're going to hit a lot of home runs together. Here's why. He shared all of his professional qualities. And look what happened. Recruiter with Microsoft here. How can I help? Really valuable, okay? So if you're looking for a job, if you spend the time, let's say it takes you 3 weeks to craft the most impeccable article, right? As soon as you put that article out there on LinkedIn, right, its reach is amazing. Alex closes the article with a call to action. He lists out 3 ways that people can help, that they can like, comment, and share, that they can connect him with a colleague, and that they interview him. So people know exactly what they're supposed to do at the end. Let's talk about crushing interviews. Let's talk about the interview process, preparation for the interview, and how to stand out. Okay? Let's see. Now, this talk was not specifically geared to engineering because it was more of a general talk, but I do have some things on the engineering side and the non-engineering side. And like I said, the one unifying factor is impact. So interview process. Usually there's 4 steps to the interview process. There's some type of phone screen. This phone screen can sometimes be eliminated by going to career fair, right? That those formalities of, hey, how you doing? Are you willing to move to, you know, Seattle for Amazon? Those type of things, you know, you don't have to deal with anymore if you've gone to a career fair. So that gets skipped. And then the next step is some type of online assessment. This may take you between 30 minutes to an hour. It might be a writing exercise. Mine was like a I believe it was like a 2-hour writing exercise for Amazon. It may be interpreting data. It might be a strategy question. Or on the engineering side, it will definitely be a coding question, coding challenge. The next step, if you pass that step, is a 45-minute to a 1-hour phone interview with one or more people from the prospective team. At this time, they're going to dive deeper into your background. They're going to ask you role-specific questions. And we'll get into that a little bit further. And, you know, this is one of the main reasons here that you want to make sure you never embellish on your resume, right? And we talk about impact, but you go, I don't have any impact, but these companies want to see impact, right? So, you know, people kind of, you know, stretch what they achieved. The thing with these companies is that they're going to ask you tons of probing questions. What did you do here? What was that 11%? Huh, why did you give me that answer? Tell me more. Oh, that's interesting. Tell me more, tell me more, tell me more. And they get down to the very base of if you made a decision correctly or not, if you had the right frame of mind going into it, right? If you're thinking correctly about this problem. So make sure you're very honest on your resume because they will tear it apart when they get into an interview with you. The fourth thing, is if you're invited to an on-site interview for a round of in-persons, at Amazon, there was a round of 5 interviews. 45 minutes, back to back, there's about a 10-minute break in between, and I don't think I had lunch either, actually. And that was the same thing at Uber, too. They just really kinda, they go for it. At Google, same thing, 4 or 5 individuals that you'll interview with. But here's the thing, guys. If my mouse, oh, there it is, okay. Google and Amazon and many other large tech companies, there's no secret about what they're doing and what they want from you. It's on their website, right? They give you every possible thing you need to succeed. They give you every resource, every website, every YouTube video to watch. They tell you what books to read, and they tell you what order to do it in. Like I said, all you have to do is put in the hard work. For Amazon, I prepared for around 40 hours. Google, about the same. I was talking to a buddy yesterday. He prepared for over 100 hours for his Google interview. So he referred to his process as a marathon. And you really need to look at it as a marathon. You need to get very, very comfortable with putting in the time over a long period of time and getting comfortable with all the different types of questions that they'll ask you. Follow a suggested path. Careers.google.com, how we hire. Goes over absolutely everything. Careers.google.com/students, from a student perspective, absolutely everything you need right there. Amazon, Google, the keywords, interviewing at Amazon. Assessments, phone interviews, in person, software development topics, FAQs about Amazon, everything, right? Step by step. Now, there's a couple things that I want to talk about that are the nuances within all this stuff. Because even if that's common knowledge for you, maybe some of this other stuff won't be. I like to think of the interviewing process or getting prepared for the interviewing process as this top layer, this blue layer. I spend a lot of my time understanding what are the leadership principles of the company, what's the news, stressors, pain points, things like that. Because that gives me a lens by which I can view everything else that I'm studying, from coding interview questions, to behaviorals, to general, why do I want to work here? What do you like about working? Or what do you like about this company? To sizing, design, and strategy questions. And I'll touch on these briefly. Oops. Okay. Coding questions. So if you're going after an engineering role, you should be familiar with syntax of languages, Java, Python, Ruby. You should know how memory management works. You should know how to use commonly used libraries. You'll be expected to know runtimes for common operations, as well as how they use memory. And you're expected to know object-oriented programming, object-oriented design. Now, if you're going after a product management role at Google, you will get coding questions, but they will be a little bit more conceptual. They want to understand that you know. They want to understand that you know how to break down really large problems. But it's not as intense as engineering. On the behavioral side of questions, these are typically in the format of, tell me about a time when you did something. Tell me about a time when you achieved something, right? Very open-ended. And these questions are really important for Amazon. It's a foundational element of all questions for Amazon. In fact, engineers, product managers, marketing, everybody gets put through the behavioral interview, as well as the coding side of things. Whereas at Google, you're not really going to be asked behaviorals if you're going after an engineering position, because they really want to understand if you know your stuff on that side. They're going to ask you general what whys, like, why should we hire you? You should definitely have a great answer for that. I read the book, The Everything Store, a book about Amazon. I learned about the culture and why at Amazon, all of our desks are made of cheap balsa wood doors. Because one of the leadership principles at Amazon is frugality. So doors are made, you know, doors are just strapped to table legs because we're always thinking about saving money. And even in our conference rooms, it's hilarious. You would think Amazon's got all this money, right? Our conference rooms have 10 tables of foldable plastic Rubbermaid tables, right? Because that's ingrained in everything. And so, and then you have these market sizing estimation questions, right? Estimate how many messages are sent to Facebook each day. How many footballs can fit in a stadium, right? They want to know those type of things. Like, can you break down this big thing that's kind of ambiguous that you probably are never going to get an answer to and start going through the process? How to stand out. Okay. So you want to make sure all your answers embody the core values of the company, that's framed in your mind. You want to also make sure that you use the SAR method for answering questions. situation, action, result. So when somebody says to me, tell me about a time when you did this thing, I can't just launch into the result or the action because I have no context, right? So tell me the situation that you were dealing with, the action that you took. Maybe it's a goal you set up, and then paint the result. Number three, we get into this mindset that maybe we can't ask clarifying questions, that we gotta be quick to answer, right? Or else we'll be judged. But they want you to ask clarifying questions. If you don't know, ask them. They're happy to tell you. They're happy to guide you through that process. Number four, refrain from using we to describe what you achieved. If you say we in one of these interviews, the first thing they're gonna go is, did you do this? And it's gonna be a little bit awkward. Number five, if you're completing a coding or strategy question, you wanna make sure you say your thoughts out loud, right? Because it's as much about your thought process, not so much about you getting the right answer, right? It's about collaboration and your thought process. I was talking to a PM at Google recently, and she said she was asked a whiteboarding question. She'd never seen it before. She had no idea how to answer it. What she said to the hiring manager was, I literally have no idea how to answer this question. But what I'd love to do is work together to solve it. She got the job. Number six, conceptualization, not memorization, right? Because they ask you all these probing questions about things, they're really wanting to get to your core understanding or the core achievement. With coding or with strategy questions, right? Do you really understand this thing? So that's really important. And number seven, if you're answering behavioral questions, try to use data anytime you can, right? Because they care about data. And lastly, number eight, be excited about the role, right? As nervous as you are in the interview, smiling and actual excitement, or almost nervous excitement, is okay, right? They wanna know that you really actually wanna work there. How are you evaluated? So while you're being interviewed on site at Amazon or Google, you notice that when you answer the questions, the people that are listening to you are on their keyboard like this, and they're not even looking at you in the face. It's a little bit unnerving at first because they're taking tons of notes. Because those notes get compiled for a review. And for Amazon, all five people that interview you, each person will read each other's feedback. You'll have a 30-minute to a 1-hour session, and you'll have a debate. It's one person that interviewed you in the loop of five who is called a bar raiser. And the bar raiser is an objective third party. They're not even on that team. Their goal is to be objective, because a lot of times hiring managers, they're so bogged down by the role, they need relief. That's why they're hiring somebody else to take on that job, to provide relief, to expand, to do whatever they need to with their goals. And they make snap judgments, and those decisions might be the wrong decisions. So that objective third party has a veto power in the room. So even if everybody agrees, they have the ability to say no. Now, with all the people who interviewed you, they're looking at Amazon specifically to see if you embody the 12 leadership principles. One of those leadership principles is frugality. One of them is think big. One of them is dive deep. If you want to know all of them, you can just go to their website, type in leadership principles, and you'll find them. But that's a key thing that they're looking for. Now, at Google, it's a little bit different. So they hire by more of a committee. And so the feedback gets gathered by the manager from everybody, and it gets passed as a packet to a committee. And they are literally objective. The whole committee is objective. They're not even on your team, right? So it's even more of a kind of a difficult situation because there's no biases entered into that scenario. They're clearly looking at it as, do they meet the skills? Do they meet the principles of the company or not? A couple resources here, guys, that I think are really important. You've probably heard these before, maybe some of them that you haven't. Gail McDowell has a website called careercup.com. She has mock interview questions specifically for engineering students. They're really, really good. She's written 3 books. She's actually maybe written more books. One is Cracking the Coding Interview, Cracking the PM Interview, and then Cracking the Tech Career. Steven Skiena also, the Algorithm Design Manual on the coding side of things, very important. On the engineering side, great website to test your coding skills, practice for coding interviews. One of my buddies was using this website almost every day when he was working at American Express and trying to get in to Amazon. Let's talk about something else that's really important here, guys. Luck, timing, and personality fit. I had somebody tell me today, I'm getting rejected a lot and I don't know why. My background is awesome. And I was like, yeah, absolutely. Your background is awesome, but you're applying and praying. Maybe you're doing some things wrong. But at the end of the day, we're all humans, right? A human that's interviewing you may be having a bad day. They're using their biases, right? You could think that everything went perfectly right. And in fact, maybe somebody just didn't like you, literally just didn't like you. Right? It had nothing to do with your skills. So I'll share one insight here. I was in an elevator with a guy. I won't name names or companies. But the guy said, I'm having a shit day. And I said, oh, that sucks. And he goes, I got an interview right now, and I'm not going to give an accept decision. Right, because I've had such a shitty day. And he walked out and he said, sucks for them. That's tough. That's tough, right? So, but it's true. This type of stuff actually happens. This book, Daniel Pink, wrote the book When, The Scientific Secrets of Perfect Timing. The following graph shows that people's self-reported levels of enjoyment throughout the day rise and fall throughout the day. So this encounter was at 3 p.m. in the day, the lowest happiness on average of anyone, right? So the key takeaway here, guys, is if you're setting up an interview, try to set it up between 9 and noon. It actually is a thing, and it really matters. So what's my secret, guys? Oh, not the end. What's my secret? All right, so my junior year of high school, I was kicked out. My average GPA was 2.8, not on a 4.0 scale, but on a 7.0 scale, okay? I was failing very, very miserably, okay? I did not take those years very seriously. And, you know, I tell you this, I also didn't go to an Ivy League college, right? I probably didn't go to an Ivy League college because I probably couldn't get in because my grades were so bad. But I tell you this to remind you that there's no magic to getting in. There's no VIP door, right? It's not that people are somehow smarter than you. The only difference, like I said before, is hard-ass work and using the resources that you have available to you. That's it, guys.